Welcome to our worship service at First Unitarian Society of Ithaca. As the season turns to fall in all its beauty, may we continue to reach for connection, even while distanced. Dig deep for inspiration, even in those moments when we feel burdened, and strive to engage with this complex world as we shepherd our community through this uncertain time. My name is Magdalene Lindeberg, and I am the Celebration Associate today. Thank you so much for joining us. Welcome to everyone, whether you are newcomers or longtime attendees, members of the Ithaca community, or watching from afar. We are so glad you have chosen to worship with us this morning. Be sure to check your email, our Facebook page, and our website for more information on how to create connections. If you'd like to receive our weekly updates describing opportunities for engagement, please email a request to office@uuithaca.org. Our speaker today is Reverend James T. Galasinski from the Unitarian Universalist Church in Canton, New York. He has been there since 2016, and before that time was a ministerial resident in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Like me, he began life as a Lutheran in Wisconsin, and he has also worked professionally as a jazz musician. Today is a pulpit exchange between Reverend Galasinski and our own Reverend Margaret. Our service this morning has been pre-recorded, but we look forward to sharing the service broadcast on Sunday morning and seeing you at the live coffee hour that follows. Welcome.
This morning, now, here, give up the fight for some other moment, some other life. Give up the longing for some other world, the wishing for other choices to make, other songs to sing, other bodies, other ages, other countries, other times. Surrender to this body, this life, this day, this hour. Not because it does not constantly break your heart, but because it also beckons with beauty and startles with joy. This is the gift we have been given, this pulse, this breath, this day, these friends, this hope. All of us now giving thanks for the one life that is before us.
We will now do the chalice lighting. We light our chalice, ancient symbol of communion and equality, symbol of mystics and heretics, reformers and refugees, artists, activists, and Unitarian Universalists everywhere.
Thank you. Hi, friends. It is such a blessing to be able to share this time with you each Sunday morning. In case you've forgotten, now is the time to go and run and find your packet. It's the last one for this month. It's dated 9/27. I hope that this month has brought to you all a sense of being settled into a new routine. You're all starting to feel more comfortable with school and work and the new season. And I bet that there have been a lot of changes, haven't there? All right, go ahead and open up your packet. See what's inside. Pipe cleaner. Feel free to do what I do with the pipe cleaner, mimicking what I'm creating or create what you would want to create with it as we're doing this together. So first, my pipe cleaner is nearly straight. Now I can change it by bending it. I can change it again by bending it some more. I can take my pipe cleaner and I can put it in a circle around my wrist, and I can make myself a little bracelet. Take my pipe cleaner off, and I can twist it together, and I can make it shorter and shorter and shorter. I can make it really small. And then I can untwist it, maybe, and I can make it long again. What can you do with your pipe cleaner? I bet that all of you are finding way more creative things to do with yours than I thought to do with mine. I know that pipe cleaners are meant to change. We are meant to change too. We need to expect change. What changes have you experienced? Have you ever moved? Have you experienced changes to your body or how you view the world as you've grown? Maybe your favorite food or favorite color has changed over time. Some changes are big, like moving to a new city. Some are little or even temporary, like dyeing your hair or getting a new pair of shoes and then outgrowing them. One change we've all had this year is not being able to come together for church. And I miss seeing all of you so much. This is a change that feels really hard. And our hope is that we will be able to be together again soon. Perhaps another change has been that you have been able to set up an altar at home with your family during this time when we can't be together at church in the building. Maybe you made a chalice out of a glass bowl or Play-Doh or Legos or something else you found in the house. Perhaps you put that chalice on cloth and members of your family brought items that have meaning to them. Perhaps a bell or a chime, bowl with some water or some pictures. I hope that if this is a change that you have been able to make, that you would consider sharing some pictures with me of your sacred space and what that looks like in your own home. Our church is changing too. And I don't just mean that our building is largely empty. As you use, we continue to look for things that are true and help us understand life. Our faith expects and encourages change. It's called ongoing revelation. Orthodox Christian faith sees one revelation, one truth that is unchangeable, that Jesus Christ came into this world to save us, and that the Bible is the single unchanging source of truth. UU faith sees ongoing revelation, an ongoing search for ever-changing truth. Right now, we are trying to understand why some people are treated badly and trying to figure out how we can best help. We never know for sure what truth we will find. I encourage you all, as we continue into the fall and are faced with change, maybe more than we're used to or want, let yourself be open to the changes that come. Allow yourself to be open to the ongoing revelation.
I invite you into the practice of meditation. I invite you to feel your feet flat on the ground. Breathe in a few breaths with me. Breathe in through your nostrils and exhale through your mouth. Begin to let everything in your body melt. Let your dust settle. Let everything, all of it, go. Remind yourself that you do not have to go anywhere. But here. We do not have to be anyone but ourselves. Let your thoughts flow where they may and notice this peace within you. It is there. It is coming forth like the crimson leaves are. A simple, a natural peace, like calm, regular waves of water. Settle into this moment of shared peace and shared silence. So may it be.
Each week, we take an offering to sustain the important ministries and programs of this congregation and its presence in Ithaca. This Sunday is a sharing Sunday, and our donations will be given to Loaves and Fishes of Tompkins County. The staff and volunteers of Loaves and Fishes are committed to working together to provide free meals for all Tompkins County residents in need during the coronavirus situation. Located in St. John's Episcopal Church, Loaves and Fishes is a Christian ministry providing a place for free meals, hospitality, companionship, and advocacy for those in need, regardless of their faiths, beliefs, or circumstances. Currently, Loaves and Fishes is serving meals to go Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from noon to 1 p.m. and Tuesday and Thursday from 5:30 to 6:30 p.m. All are welcome. May these gifts bring about connection, inspiration, and engagement within these walls and beyond.
Greetings from your Unitarian Universalist family and friends to the north and east of you in Canton, New York. When the Reverend Margaret Weiss and I talked over a year ago now about doing an annual pulpit exchange, I thought it would be a great excuse for me to spend a weekend in Ithaca. So I very much miss being with you in person and enjoying you in your great city as I did last September. The reading I chose for today is the 10th chapter of the Tao Te Ching, the ancient sacred text written about 2,500 years ago in China. Can you coax your mind from its wandering and keep to the original oneness? Can you let your body become supple as a newborn child's? Can you cleanse your inner vision until you see nothing but the light? Can you love people and lead them without imposing your will? Can you deal with the most vital matters by letting events take their course? Can you step back from your own mind and thus understand all things, giving birth and nourishing, having without possessing, acting with no expectations, leading and not trying to control? This is the supreme virtue. This ends our reading for today. The band was not getting along. The Beatles would soon break up. But Paul McCartney had a vivid dream about his mother, Mary. She had died long before, when he was only 14 years old. Now McCartney awakens from the dream, goes to the piano, and writes down these immortal words. And when the night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. Paul says that in that dream, he could hear his mother, Mary, say, "It will be all right, just let it be." Paul later said in an interview, "It was great to visit with her again." I imagine Paul McCartney, the bassist and beloved Beatle, felt much as we do right here and now, disheveled, uncertain, isolated. He was struggling at the time. It wasn't just the band not getting along. Maybe he was still carrying around the grief of his mother's death. Maybe he was depressed and probably just numb to life. Let It Be may have come to him in a dream, but the wisdom here is ancient. It sounds Taoist to me. Now, from the outside, our bodies appear to be pretty much symmetrical. You know, if you take a line down the center of most of our bodies, many of us have an eye, an ear, an arm, and a leg for each side of that, you know, imaginary line. But when we take a peek inside, we see that we have specialized parts that do specialized things. Our hearts are over here on the left side, pumping away. A liver is in a different spot, cleaning out waste. It is the same thing with our brains. A brain may look pretty symmetrical, but there are areas of our brains that have specialized parts. The right and the left hemispheres, they are definitely integrated, but each side does do things a little bit differently. The two sides are connected, they work together and need each other. But the left side is more analytical, specializes in things like speech and math. The right hemisphere responds more to images and nonverbal communication. Moment by moment, our right hemisphere creates a collage of sounds, tastes, and smells. The sensations, emotions, and thoughts aren't rushed. They come as they are. Brain scientist Jill Bolte Taylor, who experienced a stroke in her 30s, lost her ability to speak and understand language because her left hemisphere was damaged. Yet she remained free to think intuitively and creatively. She found the borders between herself and other entities diminish. She felt a euphoric feeling of being one with all. The hospital, and the doctors would come into her room and ask her simple questions like, who is the president? And it would take a day's worth of strength to answer. And some feared she was in pain, perhaps brain dead, but she was, in fact, in a moment of bliss, one with the universe. And she could intuit right away which nurses and doctors just wanted to get their job done and those who really cared. A simple touch of the hand, looking in her eyes, not yelling, but talking softly. All the nonverbal communication was still available to her. It is the right side of our brain that lets things be, that recognizes our interdependence with the planet, the big picture, and has the capacity to empathize with all being. The left side, on the other hand, processes information differently. It takes all the moments and strings them together in a linear fashion. Time becomes a thing, then. The left side specializes in describing, defining, categorizing. You know, we can look at a tree, we can dissect it. This is the bark, these are the leaves. But in the left hemisphere, we like and unlike things. We put things in hierarchies. The left side excels in things like academics and assumes authority over the right. The left side is constantly chattering away, remembering the email I got to write to the congregational administrator about those reports. The left is constantly telling you what you are and aren't, a self, your identity, I am an ordained minister who lives in Canton, New York. I am a father. I am a husband. But with all that taken away, Jill, the stroke patient, could quite easily let it be. Now, for most of us, the left and right sides work beautifully together. But in a time like this, when our lives are thrown upside down, when it feels like this is going to be a long lost year of pandemic, climate change, racial injustice, and perhaps a Supreme Court shift to the right, we can become all too easily out of balance. It's difficult. How do we get into our right hemisphere's way of being when the world has stopped working in the ways we are used to it working? How do we become whole when our country is run by someone who cares more about the stock market and their re-election than human life and health? A leader who listens to the cable news instead of science. How do we let things be in this chaos? Being leaves us when those thought loops take over, when the patterns repeat. When will the pandemic be over? When will life resume and come back to normal? How many more people of color will be shot by police before things change? The Tao Te Ching says to let things take their course. Paul McCartney sings, "Let it be." They are saying the same thing, I think. Get back in balance. Get back into the right hemisphere. Letting it be acknowledges the collective grief and trauma that is in front of us and all around us. Just like we can't control the sun or the clouds, we can't do much to stop a pandemic. And that is, unless we are researching a vaccine, sometimes all we can do is wear masks and stay at home. Now, the activist in me, the one who believes in challenging and changing the world, is not satisfied and can't accept police brutality, systemic racism, and lying politicians. But if we are honest, and if we look into our souls, our hearts, we may notice the grief of losing the country we thought we had. We may be mourning the loss of control over the future. We might find ourselves having trouble regulating our emotions. Maybe our concentration levels are low, or we just can't do those complex tasks like we once could. And if we feel a bit numb and foggy, these are all signs we're grieving and we are going through trauma. Facing the pain, feeling it for what it is, loss, is okay and good. It is okay to despair. It is okay to be a mess. It is okay to let the tears roll. This is all normal. It is part letting go of expectations and accepting things as they are. We need reminders and models of let it be. McCartney helps us a bit. Whose mother helped him? The Tao can help us a bit. Then we can act without expecting results. That we can look inside our hearts, or in other words, really, the right hemisphere. During this COVID-19 pandemic, sometimes all we can do is let things be. The most ancient of wisdom. Let it be, of course, is more than words. It's things in the melody, the harmony. It is the hope. The left part of my brain, in a loop about the future, needs the balance of those sweet words whispered. All we can do is let things be and rest. And feel the suffering of the sick and the victims of racism. The more compassionate we are, the more resilient we can be. Once we come to peace and acceptance, we then can try to change what we can change, grounded in peace and relationship. But sometimes all we can do is sing. Let it be. Acknowledge the cloudy night that is before us and have the faith that the dawn will come. The deer will continue to nibble from our garden. The earth will still turn gently. The geese will fly overhead. The red maple will have crimson leaves. Sometimes that is all the hope there is. And that is enough. Amen, and blessed be. These closing words are adapted from the Reverend Max Kutz, who served many years at the congregation in Canton that I serve. After the words, a quiet. After the songs, the silence. After the crowd has scattered, only the trampled grass recalls the gathering. Peace and justice have a need for us. After the words and music and gathering, may we be granted the depth for dedication to justice. And may we be granted the will to be apostles of peace.
We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Thank you.